All right, welcome back. Let's go over some GPIO, shall we? As you can see, each QSYS core and peripheral has some sort of GPIO support. If you look at some of our legacy or integrated cores, you'll find a DA15 connector on the back. Make sure to check the GPIO number versus the connector pin number, because they don't directly correspond. Our I/O frame has the same DA15 as the 510i located here. If you look in QSYS Designer, in the control properties for a device, you have a list of pin assignments and their corresponding functionality. Here we have GPIO 1 on pin number 3, configured as a digital input. This signal would enter your schematic on the right side of the GPIO component. We also have this connection configured as an output. This signal would feed from the left side of the GPIO component. These signals follow the convention for audio inputs and outputs, so it shouldn't take too long for you to understand how to lay these out in your schematic. Also shown here are the various pins and signal types available on the DA15 connector. The layout may look a little strange on the chart, but the first three pins physically grouped together on the connector are the relay pins. Also, you'll notice that GPIO 1 is on pin 3, GPIO 2 is on pin 11, and so on. Make sure you pay attention to the properties and settings. To make these connections easier, we recommend a DA15 breakout block, which definitely makes things simpler and creates more flexibility than trying to use a crimper and pins on a D-sub connector. So to understand GPIO concepts, you first must understand the current voltage relationship. First, decide which device is providing the voltage. Then, decide which device is going to sink current. For instance, if you have a voltage signal and you need to light an LED, what device is going to sink the current and make the LED illuminate? For a better understanding, let's look at the input anatomy of your typical GPIO input circuitry. For this example, we have this input configured as a contact closure input, and the receiving dry contact will not have a voltage on it. So, the question is, how do we know when it's closed? The answer is, we need some sort of voltage to pull down so I can read it on the voltmeter, which is the intent of general purpose input circuitry. So this example shows a pull-up resistor that will need to be enabled to provide a voltage. Now we can measure the voltage until we receive the contact closure. The dry contact pulls the voltage low, and then the voltmeter in QSYS knows the dry contact is closed. The different possibilities for input configurations include a digital input TTL 3.3 volt, potentiometer, analog input, and a contact closure input. Some QSC legacy control panels may include rotary controllers that have different capabilities. So now let's look at the output side of GPIO. The anatomy of this circuit contains a transistor and some protection circuitry. If we toggle the control bit entering the circuit to be low, the transistor provides a sink to ground, which will provide a logic low on the output. If the control bit is driven high, the pull-up voltage will be present on the output. This will allow the voltmeter on the connected external device to measure a logic high voltage. GPIO output configurations that are available include digital outputs of the 3.3 volt TTL, open collector high current up to 12 volts DC, and then the pulse width modulated, or the PWM, pulse train outputs. And then finally, there's one dry relay per DA15 connector. Because the Core 110 doesn't have a DA15 connector, you will need to provide an external relay on a different device and then use the Core's GPIO digital output voltage to trigger it from the Core 110. One important thing to note is all of these connections have a resettable fuse. If you accidentally use too much current on a given output and it seems to stop working altogether, you can always reboot the core to reset the fuse. In terms of performance criteria for GPIO connections, please reference the help file, which lists all the details of the various configurations, such as volt tolerances for low logic signals, for example, are below 0.8 volts. A logic high input is going to need 2 volts or above. And you'll also find additional information including minimum and maximum voltages, current capabilities, and output impedances. As for the relays, maximums of 30 volts and 1 amp are sufficient for most applications. Power pins are approximately 12 volts, and with a maximum output current of 400 milliamps. So with most LEDs, you can power quite a few of them with the available 400 milliamp of current. If you look at the Core 110F, you'll find that it's much easier to connect using the Phoenix connector. On the back, you'll find the 12-volt connections, ground, and the 16 GPIO input and 16 outputs. These connections can be configured for digital, analog, or potentiometer connections. And then there is also a raw mode that we're going to talk about a little bit later. The outputs have three configurations: 3.3 volt TTL, open collector with a 24 volt and 200 milliamp max current sink, and again, the same resettable fuses. GPIO connections on the IO8 Flex are essentially the same, except that you have 8 instead of 16. GPIO on QSC networked amplifiers are a little bit different, as they mimic the core with a relay and typical GPIO pin on the Phoenix connector. These connections can be configured for driving LEDs, but keep in mind, these only have 18 milliamps of current in this case. These connections can also accept potentiometer, contact closure, or TTL, but no open collector or raw configurations are available on the amplifiers. Now, let's look at that raw configuration mentioned earlier. For troubleshooting GPIO connections, you can temporarily configure the pin in this raw state to expose more controls and information. As an input, you can check the present voltage and enable TTL high current. In this mode, the DA15 connector provides the most possibilities to configure the pins as inputs and outputs, or enable the pull-down internally. Keep in mind that the Core 110F and the IO8 Flex have dedicated inputs and outputs, but all other controls are still available. If you were troubleshooting, you can use this raw mode to better understand the signal level and whether it fits the behavior and the limits of your GPIO configuration. The most common GPIO application is to connect them to a microphone LED and mute buttons. Every microphone model is slightly different, so it's important to identify if the microphone responds to a contact closure or if a TTL signal is required. Also, some microphones will use phantom power and provide a voltage for LEDs on their own, while others will not. For example, the Shure MX392 has a dip switch setting that can be configured whether it's going to be a momentary or toggle mute button. You also have a simple LED operation control. Then you have the Shure MX396 with 2 or 3 microphone elements. This mic provides multiple audio signals that will need to connect to the core. There is also a single switch connection and a single output to the LED, and a ground connection. If we output a digital high to this microphone, the LED will show red, and if you output a digital low, the microphone will turn green. Here's an example design of the MX396, which has some custom controls to test the logic circuit downstream. This trigger combiner allows me to press any of the microphone buttons to act as one overall privacy or mute control. If you're in mute mode, then you can turn all of the LEDs of all of the microphones in the system to red so that everybody knows that their mics are muted. By contrast, here is a microphone example by Clock Audio. Unlike the Shure MX396, this microphone does not use phantom power for the LEDs, so you need to provide a 12-volt power supply, which, as you can see, increases the complication of the wiring. These microphones have RJ45 connectors on the Cat5 for the microphones themselves. In this system, we'll need to consolidate all of the 12-volt power and ground connections back to the core, which can power 6 of these microphones, and then distribute the green and red LED logic and the individual button wiring to the GPIO connections. For troubleshooting GPIO, you should start at the beginning by asking a few vital questions, like, what device is providing the voltage? At what levels are my voltages? If I'm configured as an output, what device is sinking the current? And is that sync current flowing in the right direction? Remember that GPIO transistors only allow current to flow to ground and not the opposite direction. Then, am I sinking an acceptable amount of current? How many LEDs am I trying to drive with the existing GPIO current configuration? Also, what is the normal state of this device? Meaning, is my relay normally open or is it normally closed? For these questions, your friend the voltmeter is very useful. What often happens with GPIO applications is the signal flow is created by one person, the wiring is done by another person, and then you have the programmer that comes in and sends the device file with all the logic, and if things don't work immediately, the programmer starts rearranging logic blocks and the signal flow rather than troubleshooting systematically from the beginning to see what QSYS sees when I push this button. Okay, GPIO was a big one. Sorry about that. Let's break right there, and when we get back, we'll look at QSYS Ethernet controls.